អង្គជំនុំជម្រះប្រកាសបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីពិភាក្សាដេញដោលតរទៅទៀតដំណើរការប្រព្រឹត្តទៅនៃកិច្ចពិភាក្សាដេញដោលអង្គហេតុមកដល់3បានឈានដល់ដំណាក់កាលនៃការស្ដាប់ចម្លើយសាក្សីចប់សុខគ្រប់ហើយកាលពីម្សិលមិញ ហើយជាបន្តនេះអង្គជំរះសួរទៅភិក្ខីថាតើអស់លោកលោកស្រីនៅមានសំណួរអ្វីត្រូវសួរដល់ជនជាតិចោតឬក៏មានបំណងលើកនៅឯកសារសំអាងដើម្បីលើកយកមកពិភាក្សាដេញដោល ដែលទីបើសិនជាមានសូមអញ្ជើញដោយស្វាតាមលំដាប់ពីសហប្រញ្ញាមេតាវីកាពីតំណាងឲ្យដើមរងរដ្ឋប្រវិនីមុនបាទបើមានសូមអញ្ជើញ
Thank you Mr. President. It was understood by all parties that we should be invited to make submissions this morning on the use to which the document from Chun Soti should be put. Can I invite the President, Mr. President, to rule that we can make submissions on that document?
អង្គជំរះសួរបញ្ហាពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងរឿងទី1ថាតើកិច្ចការទី1នេះមានអ្វីត្រូវសួរដល់ជំរាបចោតឬក៏ឯកសារផ្សេងណាទេឬឯកសារនោះគឺសហប្រញ្ញាបានលើកឡើងពីម្សិលមិញហើយហើយអង្គជំរះបានសម្រេចជាបន្តអសន្នហើយហើយអូកាសព្រឹកនេះគឺម្សិលមិញយើងបានសម្រេចច្បាស់លាស់ណាស់ថាព្រឹកនេះយើងនឹងស្ដាប់នៅមតិយោបល់ភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងឯកសារនេះ
So the document that the co-prosecutors wish to confront the accused with is the Chun Soti report. But I anticipate that, Mr. President, you would wish to discuss the use to which that can be put before we put the questions to the accused. Or have I misunderstood the situation? I wonder whether Judge Laverne has anything to add. I'm sorry, Mr. President, I should add that the Chun Soti report is about M13. It's clearly about the subject that we are discussing.
Il sera donné, bien sûr, l'occasion au parti de commenter et de faire toutes observations concernant la production du document auquel il était fait référence hier et sur lequel la Cour a tardé à statuer. Mais au préalable, je crois que le Président souhaiterait que vous nous indiquiez si vous avez d'autres questions à poser à l'accusé ou si vous entendez vous référer à d'autres documents. La question du rapport concernant Chun Soti sera examinée plus tard.
Thank you, Your Honour, for that clarification. The only other documents that the co-prosecutors would wish to put before the chamber are those that have already been referred to. The DC CAM statements of Ham In and Im Vaughan, and this together with the Chun Soti report are the only three documents the co-prosecutors wish to put before the court.
Good morning, Mr. President, Your Honours. On behalf of Civil Party 1, we have no additional questions to put to the accused. I'm grateful.
Good morning, Mr. President, Your Honours. The same for our group. We have no further questions at the moment.
ក្រុមខ្ញុំដូចគ្នាដែរគឺក្រុមខ្ញុំអត់មានសំណួរណាមួយចង់តាំងសួរទៅកាន់ជនជាប់ចោទទេសូមអរគុណបាទសូមគោរពលោកប្រធាននិងអង្គសាវនាការក្រុមមេធាវីដើមដឹងរដ្ឋវេនីក្រុម 3ក៏មិនមានសំណួរអ្វីសួរទៅជនជាប់ចោទដែរហើយក៏មិនមានឯកសារអ្វីដាក់ដែរហើយសំណូមពរឲ្យបន្តដល់
ការសួរទៅទៅនឹងមន្ត្រីសំភៃមួយបាទសូមគោរបលោកប្រធាននិងលោកលោកស្រីចៅក្រុមជំរាបសួរទីក្រុមបាទជាមេធាវីតំណាងឲ្យដំណឹងរដ្ឋនីក្រុម 4មិនមានសំណួរសួរទៅខាងជនជាប់ចោទទេហើយក៏សូមគ្រប់គ្រងនៅការលើកឡើងរបស់សហប្រជាជាតិបាញ់មិននេះបាទសូមអរគុណ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Tout d'abord, en ce qui concerne le rapport de Chen Soti, dont la défense n'a eu une copie en français que le 3 avril 2009, la défense indique à la Chambre que M. Duc est d'accord pour donner des explications sur ce document. Explications qui seront de nature à éclairer nos débats comme il l'a toujours fait devant les juges d'instruction quand on lui présentait des documents. La défense regrette seulement que les co-procureurs n'aient pas présenté ce document devant les co-juges d'instruction. En ce qui concerne les deux interviews réalisées par DC Cam, dont mon collègue demande qu'il soit versé au débat, la défense insiste pour qu'il ne soit pas versé au débat, pour que ces deux documents établi par DC Cam ne soit pas versé au débat. Je répète que ces documents ont été obtenus dans des conditions qui ne sont pas raisonnables. Ils peuvent servir sans doute à une ONG, en aucun cas à une preuve judiciaire. Je vous en donne un seul exemple. À partir de l'une de ces interviews, l'ONG DC Cam a établi un rapport très largement publié et qui est au dossier. Et dans ce rapport, sans aucun recul, sans aucune vérification, cette ONG a informé le public
qu'il y avait eu 30 000 morts à M13. Vous avez ce rapport, il a été présenté à nous au début de ces débats. Church of the Truth. 30 000 morts à M13, dit ce rapport, sur la base des interviews que monsieur le procureur voudrait faire verser. Pouvons-nous sérieusement, après avoir entendu contradictoirement dans cette audience certains témoins, continuer à laisser dire et écrire qu'il y aurait eu 30 000 morts à
M13.
Nous sommes là pour faire œuvre de justice et pas œuvre de propagande de quelque côté que ce soit. Au nom de la défense, je vous demande donc d'écarter ces documents qui ne sont pas professionnels. Enfin, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, au début de cette troisième journée de notre semaine, la Défense souhaite respectueusement mais solennellement attirer l'attention de la Chambre sur le grave problème de traduction que nous rencontrons. Tous les échos qui me parviennent nous disent que nous perdons au moins 50% des paroles qui sont prononcées en khmer. Nous sommes dans une audience de justice. Il n'est pas pensable que l'on continue à travailler comme cela. Ça veut dire que les personnes non cambodgiennes perdent 50% des messages des témoins khmer et de l'accusé. Mais ça veut dire à l'inverse que quand je m'adresse à vous, Monsieur le Président, Messieurs les juges, vous perdez entre 50 et je ne sais combien de pourcents de mes paroles. Je vous demande respectueusement mais solennellement, en vertu des pouvoirs qui sont les vôtres, d'imposer à l'administration de ce tribunal de prendre immédiatement les mesures qui s'imposent pour que nous ayons des traductions fidèles. Pour que nous ayons également des personnes compétentes qui, tous les jours, révisent les transcripts et vérifient s'il y a eu des erreurs d'interprétation. À la fin de nos débats, votre Chambre rendra une décision sur la base des paroles qui auront été prononcées ici. Je ne veux pas imaginer ce qui peut se produire si dans votre décision manque des propos qui aurait été tenu, ou pire encore, si des propos tenus sont
totalement déformé. Je vous donne un seul exemple. Hier matin, alors que le témoin parlait de trois fosses, il est arrivé dans mes écouteurs la traduction « trois prisons ». Comment fait-on ? Alors je redis qu'il existe dans ce pays suffisamment de compétences pour avoir des traductions correctes. Je dis qu'il est absolument anormal qu'il n'y ait toujours pas, après plusieurs semaines de procès, de traduction directe du Khmer au français et du français au Khmer. Je dis qu'en passant par des relais, on augmente les risques d'incompréhension. Je vous demande, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, d'user de vos pouvoirs pour donner à l'administration les injonctions qui s'imposent. Et avec tout le respect que j'ai pour les interprètes qui font un travail très difficile, je dis aussi que nous devons tous faire des efforts pour parler lentement, pour, comme vous nous y avez plusieurs fois invité, Monsieur le Président, pour poser des questions courtes. Mais ce n'est pas suffisant. Les moyens qui sont donnés dans ce tribunal pour les traductions sont insuffisants. Je vous remercie.
Simply, Mr. President, to seek your guidance on the order in which we should respond to Maître Roux's submissions. We have two issues. The issue of translation and the issue of documents to be admitted to the case file, and the co-prosecutors are content to make submissions on both issues in the way in which this court finds helpful.
សូមអញ្ជើញបាទសូមអញ្ជើញហើយការកត់សម្គាល់ទី1គឺសូមឲ្យលោកសាភិញ្ញាបញ្ជាក់អំពីឯកសារដែលសាភិញ្ញាបានលើកឡើងការពីម្សិលមិញហើយខ្ញុំរះបានសម្រេចចិត្តម្ដងអសន្ននោះថាតើលោកអាចបង្ហាញអំពីហេតុផលទាំងឡាយនៃភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនៃឯកសារនេះទៅនឹងអង្គហេតុដែលកំពុងតែធ្វើសកម្មភាពនឹងយ៉ាងម៉េច
Thank you, Mr. President. I had a request from Mr. Khan for Civil Party Group 1, who I understand has an engagement later on this morning, and he wishes to speak first on this particular matter. We have no objections for him speaking first on this, if the court is content.
សូមអញ្ជើញលោក Medavi.
Mr. President, Your Honours, I'm most grateful for that kindness. It was a matter that I did raise with my learned friend last evening. At the outset, on behalf of Civil Party 1, we would support with vigour the submissions and observations by our learned friend for the defence. It is of the utmost importance to the integrity of these proceedings and the legitimacy of the final verdict that the translation is not questioned and is reliable. Your Honours, it is, of course, it would be fatal to the integrity of these proceedings if one party or the other, at the end of the day, had viable ammunition to establish that Your Honours were not in possession of the full subtleties of legal argument. And I would support the very compelling submissions of my learned friend, Mr. Roo. It's my respectful submission that the appropriate and indeed prudent way of proceeding would be for Your Honours to instruct the Registrar to appoint an independent expert to review various samples of the translation in these proceedings since the initial hearing and to compare that translation to the original. Once we have those statistics as to the veracity and reliability of the interview, we can properly assess whether or not there is a problem, and if there is the scale of the problem, and any remedy that may be appropriate. But it does, with the greatest of respect, seem to be prudent to do that now, rather than to leave this to fester and become an issue later on in proceedings, or indeed as an appeal issue. The second observation or submission goes to the admissibility of the documents. It's my understanding now that in relation to PRN number 2214, to 2217, that's the Khmer, ERN number 00172202, in English, the statement of Chun Sothi, that there is no objection now by the defence to the admissibility of this particular document. I will therefore not belabor the point. My submission is one of principle. If I understand matters correctly, one of the points put forward by my learned friend for the defense yesterday was an argument that any document on the case file which was not shown by the co-investigating judge to a witness should be declared inadmissible. If I understood that argument by my learned friend properly, it is a novel and unheralded proposition, and it is one that I would ask Your Honours to reject. The rules governing admissibility of documents are very squarely set out in Rule 87. And Rule 87 makes it very clear that the general starting point is that all evidence is admissible. This, of course, is a civil law system informed, of course, by both the Cambodian legal tradition and informed by international standards. Your Honours, you are, of course, professional judges, and you are fully able to assess evidence and to accord whatever evidence is placed before you properly at the end of the day. As a matter of law, it's my respectful submission that there must be, of course, some minimum indicia of reliability before documents are admitted. However, it is clear from case law, and I pray in aid the Orich case before the Yugoslav tribunal, prosecutor and Orich, case number IT03 68, the judgment of the trial chamber of the 30th of June 2006, where at paragraph 29, the judges made it very clear that it is not necessary for a document to be authenticated by a witness for it to be admitted, while an exhibit which has not been presented to a witness has less probative value than one which has. It does not affect admissibility. There is, of course, as your honours are fully aware, a two-stage process, one of admissibility, and then the second one, a determination as to what weight should be afforded to a document. Ordinarily, admissibility can be viewed by the two aspects, both the form of document, whether or not there are stamps, whether or not there is an archive log, the date of receipt, and the signature, and then the contents of the document. You know, I will not labour that point, because it was primarily relevant to the report relating to Chen Sothi, for which objection is not being taken by the defence. But as far as the contents are relevant, Your Honours may hear evidence in due course, which is independent and reliable, which may shed further light. Or you may have heard evidence already, which may tend to render stronger the contents of this report, co-prosecutors are seeking to put before you. In relation to the interviews, of course, where interviews are available and a witness is before your honours, it appears that the starting point must be one of admissibility. And of course, the defence, in accordance with Rule 87, can then seek to question whether or not the document should be given any weight whatsoever. A difficulty in this case, of course, may be that whether or not an interview itself was put to a witness so that the witness is accepted, it is his interview. Your Honour, I will not go with your leave into that issue. My principal concern was the proposition which was advanced by my learned friend that documents on the case file which are not presented by the co-investigating judge to a witness should be excluded or should not be admissible. That is, as I mentioned before, a novel proposition. There is no burden in my submission upon the co-investigating judges to confront witnesses with every single piece of document, every single piece of paper on the case file in order for those documents to become admissible. To do so would be to establish a dangerous precedent for which no authority is cited in support by my learned friend for the defence. Well, those are my submissions on this issue, unless I can assist further.
អគុណលោកប្រធានអង្គជំនុំជម្រះដំណាងឯកាលើកតែទទួលសុំដើម្បីឲ្យអង្គជំនុំជម្រះលើកយករបាយការណ៍របស់ឈ្មោះឈឿនសុធីមកពិចារណាឡើងវិញដដែលដែលនៅក្នុងនោះមូលហេតុអ្វីបានជាដំណាងឯកាសុំឲ្យលើកយករបាយការណ៍នោះមកពិចារណាឡើងវិញដែលក្នុងរបាយការណ៍ទាំងនោះ ពិតមែនតែជារបាយការណ៍ដែលកាយឡ័យសហចក្រមស៊ើបអង្កេតពុំបានរកអត្តសញ្ញាណនៅជននោះឃើញវិញក៏ដោយក៏របាយការណ៍នោះវាមានការស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នារវាងចម្លើយរបស់សាក់សីដែលបានអញ្ជើញមកយកចម្លើយនៅពេលថ្មីថ្មីនេះហើយនិងចម្លើយរបស់ជនត្រូវចោតដែលបានឆ្លើយនៅក្នុងអង្គសវនាការនេះដែរ
នៅក្នុងនោះដែររបាយការណ៍នោះក៏បានបញ្ជាក់ថានៅក្នុងកំឡុងពេលនោះវាមាន
មន្ទីរសន្តិសុខ2ដែលមួយនៅក្នុងគុកគេហៅថាមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខគុកស្តាតដែលជាម៉ូ13ខវាស៊ីសង្វាក់ជាមួយនឹងចម្លើយរបស់សាក់សីនិងជនត្រូវចោតហើយនឹងម៉ូ13កដែលស្ថិតនៅអមលាំងដែលគេហៅថាម៉ូ13កនោះហើយក្នុងនោះដែរក៏មានមនុស្សជាច្រើនដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធនៅក្នុងរបាយការណ៍របស់ជឿនសុធីដែលយើងត្រូវការសុំឲ្យជន់ត្រូវចោតនោះធ្វើការបញ្ជាក់ហើយនឹងឆ្លើយតបឡើងវិញមានឈ្មោះតាធើហើយមានក្នុងនោះដែរក៏មានអ្នកទោសលួចរត់ហើយមានជនមីនជាដើមបាទលើពីនោះទៀតដែរក៏នៅក្នុងរបាយការណ៍របស់ជឿនសុធីនោះក៏មានបញ្ជាក់ពីក្រោយព្រឹត្តិការណ៍នៅថ្ងៃទី18ខែមីនាឆ្នាំ1170ដែលមានមនុស្សជាច្រើននៅក្នុងនោះមានតាធើវ៉ាន់ដែលជាក្មួយរបស់តាធើនឹងហើយប៉ុនមានអឿនមានហួតមានឈុំហើយដែលអាចសុំការឆ្លើយបញ្ជាក់ពីជនត្រូវចោតជាប់ចោតនឹងដែរក្នុងនោះដែរហើយរបាយការណ៍របស់ឈឿនសុធីនោះក៏មានបញ្ជាក់ថាគុកទាំងពីរនឹងមានមួយនៅនឹងភូមិបារីខាងលិចវត្តត្រង់ហើយនឹងទី2នៅជិតវត្តឈូកសោមផងដែរហើយក្នុងនោះដែរក៏មានរបាយការណ៍នោះក៏មានបញ្ជាក់ពីហេតុផលមួយចំនួនដែលបានចាប់ឈ្មោះហ៊ឿនដែលជាទាហានរបស់កងទ័ពជាតិនៅពេលនោះហើយរបាយការណ៍នោះដែរក៏វាមានការបញ្ជាក់ពីឈ្មោះរបស់គុកប្រធានគុកម៉ូ13ខឈ្មោះតាស៊ុំបាទលើពីនោះទៀតដែរនៅក្នុងរបាយការណ៍របស់ឈឿនសុធីនោះក៏មានបញ្ជាក់អំពីមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខនៅអមលាំងដែលមានឈ្មោះដូចដែលជាជនជាប់ចោតហើយនឹងឈ្មោះច័ន្ទដែលជាអនុប្រធានរបស់គាត់ថាជាមនុស្សសាហាវប្រៃផ្សៃផងដែរបន្ថែមពីលើនោះទៅទៀតនៅក្នុងរបាយការណ៍របស់ឈឿនសុធីនោះក៏មានបានបញ្ជាក់ថាទីតាំងរបស់របាយទីតាំងរបស់គុកស្តាតគុកនៅម៉ូ13ខហ្នឹងម៉ូ13ខឈ្មោះមន្ទីរឃុំឃាំងនៅភូមិស្តុកស្រាតដែលមាននៅមាត់ត្រពាំងខាងជើងភូមិស្តុកស្រាតខាងក្រោមហើយមានបញ្ជាក់ពីស្ថិតនៅលើអវ័យហើយមានគុកនោះមានដំបូលមានហើយមានទំហំប៉ុណ្ណាដែលខ្ញុំពេលនេះមិនលំអិតជូនអង្គជំនុំជម្រះទេហើយតែទុកជូនអង្គជំនុំជម្រះដើម្បីពិចារណាឡើងវិញទទួលយកឯកសារនឹងជាផ្លូវច្បាប់ហើយមានបញ្ជាក់ថាឈ្មោះស៊ុំនោះមានរៀងរូវភិនភាករបស់គាត់នឹងដូចបដិដដែរហើយនឹងការហូបចុកនៅរបបហូបចុកនៅក្នុងគុកទាំងពីរហ្នឹងហើយក្នុងនោះដែរក៏មានបញ្ជាក់ពីឈ្មោះឈឿនសុធីហ្នឹងដែលគាត់បានជាប់ថាគាត់នេះជាភ្នាក់ងាររបស់ជាភ្នាក់ងារយូកាហើយដែលគាត់បានជាប់រហូតពីគុកនៅស្តុកស្រាដែលជាម៉ូ13ខរហូតដល់គាត់បានចូលនៅក្នុងគុកអមលាំងគុកម៉ូ13កនឹងថែមទៀតហើយបញ្ជាក់ពីចំនួនមនុស្សអ្នកដែលជាកងការពារនៅទីនោះហើយចំនួនអ្នកទោសនៅទីនោះហើយនៅក្នុងគុកម៉ូ13កនោះក៏មានបានបញ្ជាក់នៅក្នុងនោះក៏បានបញ្ជាក់ដែលនៅក្នុងអង្គសម្ដែងការនេះមិនទាន់បានសួរថាតើនៅក្នុងរណ្ដៅនៅក្នុងម៉ូ13កនោះមានរណ្ដៅ3នោះវាស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នាជាមួយនឹងចម្លើយរបស់សាក់សីនិងចម្លើយរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតក្នុងផងដែរថាតើគុកនោះមានរៀងដូចម្ដេចហើយរបាយការណ៍នេះបញ្ជាក់ថារណ្ដៅនោះមានទំហំ2ម៉ែត្រទទឹងជម្រៅ2ម៉ែត្រហើយមានរៀងជាស្អីហើយមានបណ្ដោយ10ម៉ែត្រហើយមានរៀងជាដូចអសរកអត់មានសក់ទៀតហើយនៅក្នុងប្រឡងមកគឺថាអត់មានពាក្យសាដេញដោយនឹងសួរពីពេញភិនភាកនៃគុកដែលមាន3នឹងទេថាតើមានរៀងរៅដូចម្ដេចគាត់យើងបានបញ្ជាក់ថាវានៅចិត្តគ្នាហើយរបាយការណ៍នោះគឺមានគេសរសេរជាអសរគេគូសជាអសរកទាំងទៀតជាសកលដើម្បីបង្ហាញយ៉ាងទៀតដូច្នេះវាអាចជាប្រយោជន៍មួយដើម្បីឲ្យជន់ជាប់ចោតនឹងបញ្ជាក់ឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ថែមទៀតនៅព័ត៌មានសំខាន់សំខាន់ទាំងនេះបាទហើយចំពោះឯកសារនានាដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធនៅក្នុងដែលដូចលោកមេធាវីរបស់ក្រុមការពារក្តីរបស់ជន់ត្រចោតបានលើកនោះគឺខ្ញុំនឹងទុកភារៈនឹងជូនដល់ដៃគូរបស់ខ្ញុំដើម្បីធ្វើការឆ្លើយតប tới chứa mùi nâng ca lực láng rô bọc lúc mê thư vi rô À xa hẹn ní nằm nàng xa bề nhá chiếc nơi tại tổ tu xong oi ông chùm nông chùm đẹp nâng thư ca bì chà nà làng vinh đầm bây tổ tu yêu ai kia xa rô bọc chùm một chương dự thi nâng túc chìa bàn ca tam phá lâu chùm bạc vì bố chìa bố đà miên mùi bẩn túc nơi ca tiên tốt khi nâng xí sẵn vạ khi nha dàng khăn rô viên xa xây nia nia nâng chùm lại bọc chùm chùm cháu hay nâng ca chì chê khi nha bì bà vót rô bọc cục màu đập bấy nâng bằng hai bì bà vót nia nia bằng thang tiết rô bọc chùm chùm cháu phong đài chùm xong bọc quân hiểm tục phê rẽ nét chùm lục đại cụ rô bọc chùm bản
Thank you, Mr. President.
Alex,
I'd just like to first state that the suggestion from the defence that the Chun Sati report has not been placed before the charged person as he then was in the investigation and then should, and therefore should not be part of the case file is irrelevant, erroneous, not based on any principle in our internal rules. If it is in the introductory submission as a document and it is in the closing order unchallenged, it is in this trial chamber's case file. That was clearly discussed in the initial hearing with all parties present, and all parties are entitled to refer to any document contained in this trial chamber's case file.
Monsieur le Président, pardonnez-moi d'interrompre, mais nous sommes à nouveau dans un problème de traduction. J'ai dit exactement l'inverse. C'est grave. J'ai dit que la défense ne voyait pas d'inconvénient à ce que le document dont vous êtes en train de parler soit versé à ce débat. Et j'ai dit que je regrettais seulement que vous ne l'ayez pas fait devant le juge d'instruction. Qu'est-ce qui a été traduit? Donc je maintiens, ça n'est pas la peine de passer des heures là-dessus, je maintiens que la défense est d'accord pour que le document appelé rapport et concernant M. Chun Sati soit versé sous réserve que vous présentiez l'original. S'il y a eu de nouveau un problème de traduction, je suis désolé. Et là, on est entre l'anglais et le français.
Perhaps it was my misunderstanding, Mr. President. My note was the defense regrets that the co-prosecutors neglected to put this document before the co-investigating judges. Perhaps I was jumping to conclusions. And I'm grateful to Mr. Roo for clarifying that he is not objecting to the document. There are two issues in this case that we're dealing with in relation to documents. There is the issue that was raised by this trial chamber in the direction on the scheduling of the trial on the 20th of March. Relating to whether the accused can be confronted with statements of witnesses yet to be heard. And the second issue is relating to the question of whether broad categories of documents, in this case, documents, statements taken by investigators from the Documentation Centre of Cambodia, can, without any more discussion be ignored by this court. There are two issues, but there is one principle. Before I discuss that principle, perhaps I can read back paragraph 9.2 of the trial chamber's direction on the scheduling of the trial. And this is document E26, ERN0029-0321 in English. The accused may be confronted with documents only after they have been put before the chamber in accordance with Rule 87.2 and 3. The accused cannot be confronted with statements of witnesses yet to be heard. And I pause and say, we, the co-prosecutors, have no objection to this. It's easily understandable the reasons for this approach. The best evidence comes from a live witness. A live witness can be asked to confirm or deny their previous statement. I'll continue from reading from the paragraph. An exception to this, the rule that I've just mentioned, is if the witness is dead or cannot be heard for another reason, and the parties have agreed to the reading of the statement. It appears to the co-prosecutors that the trial chamber is saying that unless there is agreement between the parties, the accused may not be confronted with witness statements from those people who are dead or who cannot be heard. With the greatest of respect, Mr. President, this part of the scheduling order is inconsistent with the internal rules and is inconsistent with the approach to evidence in civil law systems. Rule 87.1 is the starting point for everything that is being discussed this morning. Unless otherwise provided in these internal rules, all evidence is admissible. That's the starting point. And the only references in the internal rules to the exclusion of evidence are in two sub-rules. Rule 87.3, evidence can be excluded if irrelevant, repetitious, impossible to obtain within a reasonable time, unsuitable to proving the facts, not allowed under the law, or intended to prolong the proceedings or being frivolous. And the second and the only other rule under this court's internal rules is Rule 21, 2 and 3, that evidence obtained by or under the effective control of ECCC authorities in which inducement, physical coercion or threats are used shall not be admissible. Mr. President, there are no other exceptions to the general rule of 87.1 that all evidence is admissible. No other exceptions in the law to be applied by this chamber to this case. The co-prosecutors are extremely concerned that the trial chamber appears, as supported by the defense, to be moving towards a ruling based on the directions of the 20th of March. That is to say, there is an additional test for witness statements made by witnesses who are dead or cannot be heard, namely that additional test being that the parties must agree. I return to the general point. There is no distinction in our internal rules between witness statements and any other type of documents. All documents are subject to the same broad rule of admissibility. A witness statement made out of court, legally speaking, is no different to any other document made outside the court. And we have many hundreds of those documents, thousands in fact, that this court will hear and consider during the trial. Military telegrams sent to the party center, written reports of chiefs of administrative units sending prisoners to S21, handwritten notes from interrogators. Is the trial chamber going to say that some of these documents cannot be used because we cannot bring the person who made the statement to court and there has been no agreement by the defence? I hope the court will see that the potential impact of the direction in which this discussion is progressing is extremely dramatic. There is no basis in our internal rules whatsoever to say that in all cases where the author of a statement is dead or not available, only those documents agreed between the parties are admissible. And there is good reason for that. It would put the power of controlling the admissibility of documents in the hands of the opposing party instead of in the hands of the trial chamber. The defence could simply say, we don't agree to any documents for which the maker of the statement cannot be found or is dead. And that would just simply prevent the trial chamber from considering the evidence at all. This cannot have been the trial chamber's intention. The co-prosecutors would urge the trial chamber not to import common law rules of evidence into a system of law that is not the same. As a common law lawyer myself, paragraph 9.2 of the directions seem familiar to me. Only admitting statements where the witness is dead or is unavailable looks very similar to an exception in common law to the hearsay evidence rule, evidence of statements made outside the courtroom introduced as proof of the contents of those statements. But there is no rule prohibiting the admission of hearsay evidence in the civil law system in general. More importantly, there is no rule under Cambodian law, nor any rule under our internal rules. Can I perhaps correct something that Mr. Khan said? He said that there is a two-stage test to admitting documents or considering documents before these chambers. He says that first of all there is a question of admissibility, and second of all it's a matter of weight. There's the question of weight. With the greatest of respect to him, there isn't a two-stage test. In this court, once a document is in the case file and that document has not been objected to by the defence, and I mean objected to be struck from the record, then that document can be considered. The only issue here is the weight of the document. Once it's in, it's in. I can briefly on to the issue of Documentation Centre of Cambodia statements. Is it to be said, as the defence wished, that all DC CAM statements are inadmissible because they were not taken according to the same procedures as the Poursuivre Board of investigating judge investigators without even examining the method of questioning or the quality and clarity of the responses in each individual document. The defense have consistently said these are not legal documents, therefore they cannot be used. I hope that Metro is not saying that DC CAM documents should be struck from the record, i.e., that is to say, cannot be considered. I hope he is saying that there should be no weight attached to that, to these documents. Because Rule 76.1 of the Internal Rules states that procedural defects, and in particular, in this case, the annulment of a document's addition to the case file, must be made during the investigation phase. A Rule 76 submission was never made by the defense to any of these documents. It was never made in relation to DC CAM statements. Rule 76.7, the closing order cures any procedural defects. It is not defective, therefore, that these DC CAM statements are in the case file. The defense are perfectly entitled, as is any other party, to say that this statement or that statement should be given little weight or even no weight, because there are no judicial guarantees, because we don't know the training of the investigators, because we don't know the quality of the interpretation. The co-prosecutors have no trouble with those arguments at all. But no matter how eloquently Maître Roux pleads, he cannot get over the rule applicable in this case, in our court, that once the document is before this court, it cannot be struck from the record. And I hope I've not mistaken Metro Hu on this point. If I have, I'm sure I'll be corrected when he responds. Mr. President, some DC CAM statements may be more useful to this court than others. It won't have escaped your notice, Your Honours, that some of these statements contain leading questions. It won't have escaped your notice that some of the questions do not appear particularly relevant. But each document must be judged on its own merits. Each individual document must be judged on its own merits. And there is nothing within the rules of this court to say that certain categories of documents have an additional test of admissibility. Even the procès-verbaux taken by the co-investigating judges vary in quality and clarity. And as I've said, the submissions of the defense that the court might give little or no weight to certain documents is perfectly proper. But to take a blanket approach for whole categories of documents is not permitted by these internal rules, by our internal rules. The issue is a simple one. The documents are admissible because there is nothing that makes them inadmissible under these internal rules. There is no requirement under our rules that all parties must agree. This relates to both the observations in relation to previous witness statements and also to the DC CAM statements. To find otherwise would create an extremely dangerous precedent for this court and the prosecution of the cases before these courts. To find that this chamber can create additional rules of admissibility of evidence is not within the power of this chamber.
The
co-prosecutors cannot see any basis for rejecting documents on the simple fact of the category of that document.
My
colleague has already set out the relevance and usefulness of the Chun Sothi report. I hope I have established the co-prosecutor's position on DC CAM statements. And if we are to discuss individual DC CAM statements and the weight to be attached to them, the co-prosecutors are perfectly happy to do that on a statement-by-statement basis, which is the only proper approach this court can take. I apologize for taking so much time up of your honours, but this is a very important issue, and those are my submissions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. We would like to submit the following concerning this issue. First, we observe that here and as we saw yesterday in the discussion, if we can refer to a document which is on the case file, a clash between common law rules and civil law rules. Would like to emphasize we are here in a civil law proceeding, and therefore I think it is most important that the trial chamber takes a decision which is in accordance with general civil law proceedings rules, and not to make a case-to-case test on every document if it is in general admissible. First, I would like to submit that we join fully the statement of the co-prosecution, and I do not want to repeat these arguments that we share in total, including the inconsistency of the mentioned decision E26 in their paragraph 9.2 with the rules and including the statement of Mr. Khan related to the two-step test, which we do not share. I want also to add another point regarding to Rule 87, which should guide these proceedings, and which is in accordance with the Cambodian Criminal Procedure Code, that under Rule 87.2, which I will read out, any decision of the chamber shall be based only on evidence that this is the first element. Second element that has been put before the chamber and next element subjected to examination. This is the rule which makes it very clear that the final decision, judgment at the end has to be based on these elements. We are looking then and making the test regarding to witness statements which are on the case file. That means they can be used. They are pieces of evidence, of course, as document as such. And if they are put before the chamber and are subjected to examination, final decision of the chamber can be based on these statements which are part of the case file and are documents. They can be only excluded. And there, I do not want to repeat this under Rule 87.3. As the prosecution already outlined. Of course, such documents, like most of them DC Chem documents, where witnesses were asked, and we have a report on the case file on this question. If the witness, which is, I want to say, behind this document, then, of course, the priority should be shed on the witness. The primary source should be the witness if the witness is available. If not, this document is a document like other documents. And can and should be considered by the chamber. This general treatment of evidence should be ruled by the chamber, and I think it is then only the question at the end that it is the duty and the very own duty of the chamber to consider the evidence and to weigh if, for example, a document contains a statement which seems to be credible, consistent, and consistent within itself and consistent with other evidence. The same duty and the same book that the chamber has for considering witness statements given orally in court. And therefore, it is up to the chamber at the end to determine what way should be ascribed to the evidence deduced. And only if the chamber
If evidence is excluded under Rule 87.3, it cannot be considered. This is not the case in general for all statements. And this is in accordance, and I repeat this because I think we are here in the courtroom and in a mixed, or mixed composition of common law tradition,
common law
officials and civil law,
lawyers
and judges. And I really call on the chamber to take follow the civil law approach. And I would like to add that, of course, as we face a lot of translation problems,
the
chamber should take into consideration here in court the original documents,
and
as we saw with the statement of, for example,
Inham,
that there were so many inconsistencies between the English and French version already, as I understood. And so I suggest to refer here in court primary to the original documents are often concerning the DC Chem statements recorded, as I have understood, and can be tested, of course, if the transcript is accurate. So to conclude, only on this issue, not covering yet the translation problem, all evidence which is on the case file can be used. And this rule should guide and guide the chamber, which is in accordance with the Cambodian law, with the rules, and with civil law proceedings. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oui, merci, Monsieur le Président. Pour le groupe 3, je formulerai donc deux types d'observations. Premièrement, en ce qui concerne la traduction, je m'associe pleinement à la requête présentée par Maître Roux, cela va de soi. En tant qu'avocat, nous sommes auxiliaires de justice. J'ai déjà eu l'occasion de dire que nous recherchions ici la manifestation de la vérité, quelle qu'elle soit. Certains aspects de ce procès seront jugés sur les déclarations qui sont faites à l'audience. Il est important que nous ayons tous une compréhension fine, qu'il n'y ait aucune ambiguïté, que le jugement final soit fondé en droit et équitable au plan humain. Il est donc nécessaire que la traduction soit précise et fidèle. Encore une fois, je m'associe totalement à la requête qui a été présentée. En civil law, nous avons coutume de dire, lorsque nous demandons à un témoin de prêter serment, qu'il doit s'engager à dire la vérité, rien que la vérité, toute la vérité. Je crains dans ce débat qu'une partie
de la vérité nous échappe simplement parce que nous ne comprenons pas ce qui est dit. Voilà ma première observation. Deuxième observation sur la production des documents. La particularité de ce procès, Monsieur le Président, Mesdames, Messieurs, est qu'il est constitué des actes d'instruction et d'une multitude de documents recueillis parallèles. Alors, je voudrais m'exprimer sur le plan du bon sens et sur le plan du droit. Sur le plan du bon sens, l'intérêt de nos débats est de pouvoir comparer, de pouvoir confronter l'ensemble de la documentation, l'ensemble des renseignements aux déclarations qui sont faites ici.
C'est l'utilité
des débats de confronter l'ensemble des renseignements dont nous disposons. C'est la raison pour laquelle, Monsieur le Président, hier, j'ai respectueusement, mais très fermement, demandé à la Chambre qu'elle nous dise le mode d'emploi pour que nous sachions très clairement le sort qui sera réservé à ces documents, qu'une décision soit prise, qu'un mode opératoire soit défini et nous ne reviendrons pas. Mais, en droit, règlement intérieur, règle 76-2, règle 76-7. Je lis simplement. À tout moment de l'instruction, si la partie estime qu'une pièce de la procédure est entachée de nullité, elle présente une requête motivée au juge d'instruction leur demandant de saisir la chambre préliminaire aux fins d'annulation. Sauf erreur de ma part, cela n'est pas
possible.
J'en viens donc à la règle 76-7 évoquée par M. le co-procureur il y a quelques instants. L'ordonnance de clôture devenue définitive couvre, s'il en existe, les nullités de la procédure antérieure. Aucune nullité ne peut plus être, de procédure ne peut plus être invoquée devant la chambre de première instance ou la chambre de la Cour suprême. Je me permets de dire, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs de la Cour, que nous sommes en train de discuter sur un faux débat. La question, me semble-t-il, est entendue. Je demande respectueusement à la Cour de rappeler à l'ensemble des parties que cette règle-là que je viens de lire est d'ordre public, que nous devons la respecter et que nous devons, pour la fluidité des débats, continuer. Je vous remercie, M. le Président.
បាទមេនិកខ្ញុំបាទបាន lực lao rụi hái thật cho bạn bạn quan trô nó ca lực lao bỏ xạ về nhà chẳng được không đi khi mà có mình copy lục lục xây mê thì vì lực môn môn đá đã có đoàn lực lao trẻ tôn cho mùi nâng cả bằng hai phó tăng chứ ai cái xa để cầm bông tá đánh đọc này nè để cho trẻ tôn là ai cái xa đài miên xạ xây cho mùi chân sử thi hào dưới lần ní lục mê thì vì cá phía lục mình mang chùm tỏa tế bởi tạm khiêm sạp bàn tạm cả bọn bà vẫn thế trẻ tôn tôi nâng ai cái xa đài tranh rưu sắp xa đói ông ca si đi khám rưu mà chạm đồ là sao chứ ai cái xa chết ai cái xa xoay đồ cả bật để chạy nâng khăn lý ca lực lãng rồi bỏ mê thì môn môn là có lực ẩm bì vị thiên bát sắp rồi buồn đó xong tôi bát sắp rồi bật bát sắp rồi bật bì vị thiên này phó tàng nó trong chùm nói tì bì nên chùm nói tì bay đôi cái nhà siêu kệ Sudzinski lực lãng bánh mạnh chùm át xong con trò tiếng sống lúc thả ai cái xa tiếng ơ ní khi mà bị nứt mờ tàu khơi miên phiệp tẹt tồn khía để sróp khía nâng chùm nói tì bay vị thiên bát bơ chùm nói tì bay hay ảnh lụ vị thiên bát xâm bơ bay cỏ đơn giản thà bà sân mình bẹp quan khía từ ông sạo nà ca rư lục vị thiên đặc nom ông sạo nà ca nâng thưa ca xâm rạch bạc để xa chào hay tì bí tiết tẹt tồn chùm bùi nâng phiếp mình ai cho rộp bán khăn nông điệp bí xóm xóm nà mùi nục bần ta khăn nông khăn nông cả ăn vọt tàm sĩ vi lo nông cứ rô ai kia xa tàng ọt để bán đạm bánh chú ta khăn nông xóm nông rừng hái nông khăn nông vật thiên nít bán pra bị thả phó tăng để miên nông khăn nông xóm nông trâu bán chặt tục thả bán lực lan nông chùm buông múc ong chùm nông chùm rác xa la nông bồn thì bạn trai nhạc cho bác nhau được chứ này hai bà sân chị tẹo tôn tôi chỉ mua nâng cho bác chiếc rồi bỏ bởi chi nó chạy cảm với chiếc nó khăn nông nị tệ vị thi gram nị tệ vị thi rồi bởi vì nị nị bởi chi nó chạy cảm với chiếc chanh nó khai cả đá chân nàm bì bòn bởi mùi trong mịt ràm mùi rối hà sạp bàm bạn trai nhạc bì phiếp trăm trâu khăn nông ca thu ai kì xa tụ bây thả nị chỉ riêng bộ một toán có bàn tay nó khăn nông cách bộ một riêng rồi viên ông ca sạc bị chiếc chỉ mùi nâng dưới thập bà cam bị chiếc nó khăn nông mệt ra đạp bì như dưới em bì cả bà miền phim mình chứ bà loa rứ miền nây mình trăm trâu nó dục chứ bà chiếc chỉ thông nếu chưa ạ tên này là khi bà lực lần chẳng mệt ra mà rồi hà sạp răm bàn chanh phiếp trăm trâu khăn nông ca thư ai kia xa khi mà xong anh nhạt anh bình tích luôn mình về anh bình tích thì mùi phía kia đại bàn sản xâm ai bình tích phó tăng chỉ ai kia xa trâu bằng chạy thả ai kia xa nu trâu bàn thua lãng đói trầm trâu chúng ta đi bí bao tờ tuôn sqal thả ai kia xa trâu bàn thua lãng đói mình trầy rì chká nâu khăn nông mục nế tí đòi bà ách lưu tùm rung nâng khâm xa nê ai kia xa nô trâu xa nô mọt thà chỉ ai kia xa xa thiên nạn đại bán thua lãng đau trầm trâu chúng ta tị bấy bà mươn mừng tư xong say tư lơ phiếp trầm trâu khăn nông ca thua ai kia xa xa thiên nạn nốt là ca ai xua đau chăn tiền nó sắt tàu cửa xuống rưu tha ban đại bẹ còn bàn trong khi mát xong an bay chấm nói như hai khi mát có xong bệnh thiệp nâng còn xong qua thả tôi bay ong ca si đi khem đại lục mê thử vi ca bê lực lãng thả mình men chìa mình toàn xong mặt thả chỉ nhẹ miên xong mặt thập hiếp rưu đại 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 trò bàn tàu tu xoal đòi sở tha ban từ la ca cả đói có bàn tay ai cái xa tiếng ơn ni mình nên tập bàn ni thế miền trời nó rập mưa nó rập sai nó rập liên tụm po tập tiếp đại ban nọc pi ông ca si đi khám đã chôn một nòng องจุ่มนุ่มจุ่มเรียกวิสมัยขนมตลาดกาคำจีนี่ฉันขนมบ้านสมตลอดทอยกราเวงองกาสิทธิคำนี้ตราบ้านตัวสกอตเจ็บเพลากาโดยยึดวัฒนธรรมกัมพูชีอันยัดจีเพลากาไอสไฟนิโรคสาวชิลิโรครอลไอกิซาหรือพอตังถึงหลายแต่แตะตรงขณีตอนนั้นระบบกัมพูชีปฏิได้บานกรงประเทศกัมพูชีปิดท้ายดับลำปีเมษาจำชั่งน้ำพันบริโภคจัดสปรัมมาตัวท้ายประมุ่ยแมกดาชั่งน้ำมาปอนประมุ่ยบริโภคจัดสปรัมบุญหนึ่งมิลลิลิตรพินุตติเตียนจะมาส่งจุ่มเรียบลงประเทศเจตหาองการนี้ก่อจีได้กู้ดอสำคัญลำพอดสำหรับองจุ่มนุ่มจุ่มเรียบวิสมัยของตลาดการกัมพูชีสำหรับสไลด์ตกกาเปิดจังเอาไว้ได้จะไอกระซาดจูนมกตัวไอกระซามุ่นชั่งน้ำจัดสปรัมก็ดอยไอ้กษัตริย์นครนงจันทร์ล็อกจัดสปรามมาจัดประมูลก็ได้หรือก็กล่าวเทียบก็ได้มันแม้แต่มีองค์การสิทธิแคมุ่ยตีได้ดักบรรจุหมกให้ตระบานองค์จุ่มนุ่มจุ่มเรียมีสมัยครองตลาดกาคำพิจิตรตัวดักบรรจุตกนงสนมเรื่องโดยหายยังสำคัญพัดคือชั้นเตี้ยมเสพตะบะลูกประเทศได้ดักนอมสาวนาคาตัวยกบานหรือเหมือนบ้านให้ซีสังวะเนียหรือมันซีสังวะเนียได้ลูกปริญญาจิตบานเลือกล้างบานใหม่นี่ยังจงจำนึกชะมาสมกสมกอธาการเลือกล้างหรือบ่กัญญาเมธวีสิลเกจุสตินสกี้ชะมาสมความตัวแต่งสร้องหายคางลูกสะปริญญากับชะมาสมความตัวดอยนี่ยงตัวตามบัดปัญญาได้มีใจในขนมวิถีนแปดสิบปีหนึ่งเมตราในวิถีในขนมหนึ่งเมตรามรหัสพรำในกรรมเทวิธีรับประเวณีหรือบ่ปริจินจักรกัมพูชีสมัยลูกประเทศสมราชตตุลยกไอกษาได้กำปองแต่ด้านในหมกปิจารณาหนึ่งในดาวต่อตะเทียบสมบูรณ
์ถูกมีตัวพิการไปกระไดมีนไปจองเลือกหลังไทม์ที่ได้ดีที่
Merci, Monsieur le Président. La défense ne se privera pas de participer à cet intéressant débat. En rappelant ce principe énoncé par un professeur de droit, vous m'avez peut-être déjà entendu le rappeler. Ennemi juré de l'arbitraire. La forme, c'est-à-dire la procédure, est la sœur jumelle de la liberté. De quoi parlons-nous ici ? On me parle de la règle 76 de notre règlement intérieur. Sur les requêtes en nullité pour vice de procédure, et on voudrait donner des leçons à la défense en disant mais comment donc il vous appartenait de demander la nullité des pièces de procédure avant la clôture de l'instruction. Et maintenant, c'est trop tard. Merci, mes confrères, pour ce rappel. De quoi parlons-nous ici ? De quoi parlons-nous ici ? Est-ce que quelqu'un veut me prétendre ici que l'interview réalisée par Dissicam est une pièce de procédure ? Au sens juridique du terme ? Voulez-vous que je vous rappelle ce que l'on appelle une pièce de procédure en droit de la common law, de la civil law, pardon ? Reportez-vous au dictionnaire de droit privé, définition de pièce de procédure. Elles sont insérées en cours d'instance. En cours d'instance, elles intéressent le déroulement de la procédure et l'administration de la preuve. Parmi ces pièces figurent les exploits introductifs, pardon pour la traduction, exploits introductifs, les requêtes, les conclusions des parties, ou dans certaines affaires, celles du ministère public, c'est-à-dire du procureur. Les rapports d'expertise et enfin les procès-verbaux contenant les auditions des témoins. C'est donc, j'avais à utiliser la règle 76 du règlement, c'était pour demander la nullité de procès-verbaux judiciaires. La défense n'a pas estimé, effectivement, devoir demander la nullité de procès-verbaux judiciaires, c'est-à-dire la défense n'a pas souhaité demander la nullité des procès-verbaux établis par les co-juges d'instruction, ou des procès-verbaux établis sur commission rogatoire des juges d'instruction. Donc on ferme l'article 76 du règlement intérieur qui ne peut en aucun cas résoudre le problème ici posé. Les documents dont nous parlons ne sont pas des procès-verbaux. Même si il voudrait avoir l'air d'un procès-verbal. Mais un procès-verbal est un document officiel réalisé par des personnes assermentées et en civil law, des personnes qui sont sous le contrôle des juges d'instruction.
Alors,
merci à messieurs les coprocureurs d'avoir finalement à nouveau soulevé ces questions qui me renvoient pour ma part à une critique que j'ai déjà eu l'occasion d'exprimer. Nous avons eu ensemble, messieurs les coprocureurs, un an et demi d'instruction chez les co-juges d'instruction, plus de 30 journées entières d'interrogatoire. Vous avez eu la possibilité d'apporter aux juges d'instruction tous les documents que vous souhaitiez pour que l'accusé puisse être entendu dans le cadre de la procédure d'instruction. Et je vous ai invité maintes fois à respecter cette procédure d'instruction. Et je vous ai averti maintes fois, attention, ce que vous ne faites pas pendant la procédure d'instruction, vous ne pourrez pas le faire après. Et cela s'adresse aussi aux accusés qui refusent de répondre au juge d'instruction. Après, c'est trop tard. Alors, nous sommes là dans le cadre de quelle règle, si nous ne sommes pas dans le cadre de la règle 76 sur les nullités de procédure? Eh bien, notre règlement intérieur, dans sa sagesse, a prévu effectivement autre chose. Pour les documents dont le bureau des procureurs souhaite verser un nombre considérable. Et c'est ça aussi le problème. Parce que là, nous retrouvons un défaut bien connu des bureaux des procureurs devant les juridictions pénales internationales où on amène des tonnes et des tonnes de documents. Et où l'on perd énormément de temps à trier tous ces documents. Et j'avais souhaité que dans ce tribunal, ayant la chance d'avoir des juges d'instruction, nous puissions préparer tout cela en amont pour éviter, comme aujourd'hui, de passer 2 heures alors que vous avez ici des personnes nombreuses, des victimes et d'autres qui attendent que enfin on parle de S21. On en est encore à régler des problèmes qui auraient dû être réglés devant les juges d'instruction. Alors l'article 87, paragraphe 3. Lorsque la Chambre fonde sa décision sur une preuve tirée du dossier, elle doit s'assurer que celle-ci a été produite durant l'audience. Une preuve est considérée produite au débat si son contenu a été résumé ou lu à l'audience. La Chambre peut déclarer inadmissible un élément de preuve. Je ne parle pas de nullité. Le texte dit bien, la Chambre peut déclarer inadmissible un élément de preuve s'il s'avère, premièrement, dénué de pertinence. On n'est pas dans ce cas. Et troisièmement, petit c, insusceptible de prouver ce qu'il entend établir. Je demande donc expressément à la Chambre qui prendra sa décision, comme elle l'estimera utile, de déclarer inadmissible les deux procès-verbaux, soi-disant procès-verbaux, on va dire interview, c'est plus juste, les deux interviews réalisées par DCCAM dans des conditions extrêmement discutables, ainsi également que le rapport établi par cette même organisation et appelé Searching for the Truth. Et si vous voulez encore une preuve de l'intérêt de déclarer inadmissible les éléments de DCCAM, monsieur le procureur, la défense accepte les documents originaux que vous voulez produire comme celui relatif à M. Chen Soti. Quand la défense a accepté de discuter des confessions recueillies à S21 parce que ce sont des documents de base, comment allez-vous expliquer à la Chambre le rapport de Chen Soti dont M. Duc vous expliquera d'où il provient? Et ça peut intéresser nos débats. C'est un rapport qui a été fait par le SIRPA, qui récupérait effectivement des anciens prisonniers des Khmer Rouges et qui leur posait des questions. C'était un service de renseignement. Ça intéresse la Chambre. Ça intéresse la Chambre. Et M. Chen Soti dit à propos de M13, ce centre sert à détenir et éduquer les coupables condamnés à des peines légères. Il y a de 250 à 300 prisonniers. Et vous produisez en même temps le rapport de DICCAM, page 1, page, alors excusez-moi, en français, référence 00295151. En édition française, il est indiqué PIN a estimé que de la création de M13 à sa mutation à la prison de Tuesleng, 30 000 prisonniers ont été tués. À vouloir trop prouver, messieurs les procureurs, voilà où ça vous mène. Vous êtes en train de demander la production de deux documents qui sont totalement contradictoires. Alors, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, en conclusion, je vous demande de dire que les documents de DICCAM ne sont pas des pièces de procédure au sens où l'entend la CIVILO. Je vous demande, en conséquence, de dire qu'on ne peut pas demander la nullité de ces documents qui ne sont pas des pièces de procédure. Mais je vous demande de dire qu'en vertu de la règle 87, alinéa 3, vous avez la possibilité de déclarer inadmissibles ces documents. C'est ce que je vous demande de faire. Et j'anticipe, nous retrouverons évidemment ce débat avec la question du film que DICCAM veut introduire dans ces débats, film sur lequel la défense a travaillé de son côté et qui réserve quelques surprises.
Ông nhầm ra, bậc ca, xâm ra. Cả lạc mau.